light's right in your eyes when you're up here. You ever recognize that? Hey, well. Welcome, everybody. Good morning.
Morning.
Okay, you're not used to working with me up here, are you? Of course, I'm not used to being up here in front of you either. But at any rate, I'm glad I'm here today, and I'm certainly glad you're here. Those of us who are, watching on the internet, I wish you were here, but I'm glad you're still with us. My sermon this morning has to do with our Global Outreach Sunday. You can see up there's the globe right there, and you can choose those areas wherein you can be a missionary. Today I'm going to be working from the book of Jude, Jesus' half-brother, and he's going to exhort us to live as obedient disciples of Jesus Christ. Now that's very significant on this global, as you will see in a moment. And as you can see in your bulletin, you'll notice this. It says a little sheet of paper on here and has some blanks on it. Why in the world would I do that? Well, because I'm a teacher, and I expect you to take notes, at least in your mind, if not with a pencil. It'll be up on the screen so you can see what's there. And there's going to be a quiz at the end, so be ready. Okay. Global outreach. It has to do with missions. One of the most important, and certainly one of the most common passages of Scripture and most familiar to us in relationship to missions is Matthew 28, 18 to 20. You know what that says. Go and make disciples, teaching them, baptizing them, touching the world, all the world, local and abroad, for Christ. Go and make disciples. Now, as we look at that, if I look at that in more depth, we don't have time to go through all the details, but there's two things that we can conclude. And not only me, you yourselves no doubt have concluded the same things. And one of that is that every church is to be a missionary church. Every church is to reach out, local and abroad, as missionary church. But also, if you look at this passage very clearly in Matthew, every Christian, every person who knows Jesus Christ is a missionary. In one way or another, every one of us are missionaries. And we're obligated, because we're commanded to do this, we're obligated to touch other people for Christ, whether it be how we live, and they ask, how come you live that way? We tell them, because I'm a Christian. Or what we say, we need to touch people for Jesus Christ. Everybody is a missionary. Now, individually, we all are not the same. Thank God for that. Okay. All of us can't go overseas. All of us don't want to go overseas. Some of us, like myself, stupidly, don't even have a way to get there because I don't have a visa. That's going to change. At least my wife tells me it's going to change because we're supposed to do a cruise. And I have to have a visa to go on. So that's on the books. At any rate, we all have a responsibility to participate in the missionary enterprise, but we all don't do it the same way. And there's all kinds of different ways. We have just been involved in ways, and hopefully every one of you individually have been involved when we were led through prayer for individual missionaries. That's an individual thing when we say, yes, Lord, I agree with that. Touch that person today, that missionary. That's involvement. When we pray for missionaries, some people do other things on a missionary enterprise. Some people have an actual ministry that we would classify as a missionary ministry, whether it be and at the local level, whether it be with a group or individually. But we also must face this perhaps difficult truth that perhaps there are somebody here who's not yet really prepared, not really prepared to fulfill that mandate, that requirement to go and touch somebody for Christ. You notice, when it said go and make disciples, the very first requirement of that is to be a disciple. You can't make a disciple turn somebody else into a disciple if you're not one. You have to be a disciple. Maybe some of us are not quite there yet. So you have to be a disciple before you can make disciples. Every missionary, and guess what? That's all of us who know Christ. Every missionary is to be a disciple. Now, Jude is going to tell us how to be an obedient disciple. Jude, verses 17 to 23. That's at the end, towards the end of your Bible, just before the book of Revelation. In case you're opening your Bible to that passage, it's only one chapter, so verses 17 to 23. He gives us a pattern for what an obedient disciple looks like. And that's primarily what I want to examine this morning. What does an obedient disciple look like? Well, to begin with, he tells us to remember something. You notice the passage, how it begins, as a matter of fact. It begins, "You, brothers, remember. Remember the words which are spoken to you by the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ." And then they were saying some particular things. Remember something. He who has been writing to the people in his first century world was reminding of them of what in the world their world is like. And not only what their world is like, but what that the Bible says, the actual situation that they face as Christian missionaries in the world. What are the biblical actualities there? We can start with Jesus. Jesus told his disciples, "If the world hates you, it hated me first. If the world won't listen to me, they won't listen to you." Why is that anyway? Why is it that we are, as Jesus said, in the world? Yes, we all are, but we're not of the world. We don't participate in many of the things that the people around us participate in. We are in the world, but we are not of the world. We often, therefore, are facing conflict. The world, or the church, and Jesus and Jude is reflecting upon this in his passage. Jude is reflecting upon the fact that the Christian church and the Christians who are in the church really represent a counter-cultural situation. The church is not to be like the world. If we were like the world, why would anybody ever want to come here on a Sunday? No different. We're to be a counter-cultural institution. We have something that they don't have. We have a message that they may have never heard. And sometimes, I just have to say this, sometimes even though we are supposed to exist as the polar opposite in many ways to the world's desires and objectives, sometimes, in fact, we don't quite do that. You know, one of the things that we want to do, would like to do, would be to see somebody who's not a believer and walk right up to them and say, "I've got good news for you. You're bound for hell." That's not the good news. The good news is that Jesus Christ can help you to get to heaven. But we don't do that. Why would we not want to do that? Because we're going to end up in a conflict. They might punch us in the nose. They might. They might do worse. That's true. As a cultural individual and institution, we are in conflict. I have on the screen up there some of the items that represent not only Jews' world, they were representing Jews' world, but they also represent our world. Look at some of those things. Can you deny this is not part of our world today? Moral degradation. Oh, yeah. Anybody who doesn't believe that, I got news for you. There's degradation out there. Just look at the television set and the news. You can see it. Or how about lies? Have we ever heard any lies recently? I think we probably have. There's all kinds of issues that conflict with what we believe in. And sometimes we know that we're in conflict if we make our ideas evident. We know that we'll be in conflict. But you know what the scripture says? Paul, or Jude, is saying, look, this is what the apostles were saying. In the last days, there shall be mockers coming, walking according to their own ungodly lusts. He says that. So those are the kind of people that we're going to be facing. But you know what we need? We are obligated by Jesus and the rest of Scripture that says we need to go and make disciples. We need to connect to people. We don't make disciples if we don't connect. We need to connect. But we need to do so without compromise. Sometimes in our church, in our world, perhaps, hopefully not in our church, Christians know, we know that we need to connect to the world. But sometimes we end up compromising because we don't want to end up in conflict. What we want is the whole world to come here. And so we don't want to say anything or do anything that would drive them away or say they don't want to come back. We're afraid to tell the truth sometimes. We hide the truth sometimes. It's a compromise. You know what? We exist to declare the truth to people who don't know the truth, or who don't believe the truth, or who hate the truth. That's our role. That's our job. We're going to end up in conflict. Let's accept the fact that there's going to be conflict out there. But also, let's not compromise the truth. Yeah, they may punch you in the nose. But they also may come to believe. And therefore, another person enters the kingdom of God. Well, you know what? Judas says that there's a lot of people up there who don't live like us. We know that to be true. They live as pagans in a society that doesn't think it's a pagan society. But here's what Jude says. Look, he describes these people. It's interesting how Jude likes the number three. Three times he uses three things to describe things. Here he's describing the characters, the characteristics of these people. Notice, the first thing he says, these people are divisive. They like to divide and conquer. Divisive. Notice, it's a us against them mentality. That's why we see the placards. That's why you see the people gathering in the Wall Mall in Washington, D.C. That's why you see people having parades downtown for gay rights. It's us against them. They're divisive. Are they trying to bring us all together only on their standards, but we cannot live according to their standards. At any rate, they are divisive. They were in Jude's day. They're in our day, to be sure. Just consider, for instance, the on the news already. The pro-life, pro-choice debate, it's right on the news, because President Trump is going to have somebody on the Supreme Court, Lord willing, who in fact believes in life of the unborn. At any rate, just one example of divisiveness. But they're fleshly. Fleshly as well. That means they're worldly minded. They're enthralled with the unbiblical lifestyle that is running rampant today. They love the new laws on the books that give license to sin and degradation. Things that we abhor as Christians. And yet there they are. They want us to live like them and to accept them. If we don't live like them, at least accept them as equals. Well, equals as human beings, yes, and that's true. I will. So will you. That doesn't mean that we can't tell them the truth. And if you continue to live like that, you'll burn in hell. And I don't want that. And really, I don't think you want that either. There's another way. There's a better way. The Bible has that way. But we don't believe the Bible. Well, that doesn't make it untrue. Whether you believe it or not, doesn't change truth. Doesn't change the fact. At any rate, they are fleshly and like us to be the same way, because that justifies their sin, their rebellion, if they see us doing the same thing. But since we're a countercultural individual and institution, we have to refuse that and to live a godly life in their midst. But they're also lost. This is what he says. These people are not only those who cause divisions, they're fleshly, they're having not the Spirit, literally. They are not believers. Hell is their ultimate destination if something doesn't change. And we pray and hope that our missionary endeavors will make change. Nobody wants to go to hell. I hope you don't want anybody to go to hell. I know I don't. I don't even think you want the Hitlers of the world to go to hell. Stop and think for a minute. What is hell? If we did a study on that and examined the horrors of hell, why would we want anybody to experience that? Well, at any rate, these people are bound for hell. But we're missionaries, and we have to hopefully make a change in some of that. So being an obedient disciple, according to Jude, means firstly that we remember that the Bible says the world and us, we're different. We're countercultural. We cannot ignore that fact when we go out there and try to do our missionary work. We have to accept the fact that we are potentially going to be in conflict, but we cannot and we must not hide the truth because of that fact. And secondly, he says here then, is that we are to retain our love for God. That's what he says. Notice verse 3. You, beloved, building up yourselves in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit, keep yourselves, what I have for retain, in the love of God, expecting the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. Verses 20 and 21. Notice, first off, the main verb in verses 20 to 21 is the word that I translated, retain. Your translated says keep. I said retain because it starts with an R, just like remember. Maybe you don't get into that kind of a pattern of thinking, but I do. Anyway, Jesus exhorts us to maintain our love for God. This is commonly translated as keep yourself in the love of God. Now, theologically, we need to adjust this translation, and that's almost all of your translations read that way. We must adjust it a little bit because it's not half somehow we need to keep God loving us and do something, live in such a way so that God will keep on loving us. There's nothing we can possibly do to change God's love for us. It's eternal. And he doesn't, and it will not change. It cannot change. No matter what we do in life, we cannot do anything to change that fact that God loves us. And so when he says, keep yourselves in the love of God, well, that does not mean keep yourselves in such a way that God will love you. No, that means make sure that you are showing and exercising love for God. And that's a better translation. I could go into all the details of Greek on this, but you don't want to hear that. The bottom line is, a better translation is, our love for God is what we should understand. So, we can do nothing to change God's love for us, but we can do something about maintaining our love for God. And notice, first off, this is a command. That's what mandate means. That's a command. Keep yourselves in love, loving God, in love for God is a commandment. It's not an option. It's not a good idea. It's a requirement. If you're a disciple, it's a requirement. It's something we ourselves must do. It's not something that God does for us. Otherwise, what is the word yourselves in there for if it doesn't mean something we need to do? Yes, we need to do it. But how to do this? That's the question, how to do this. Well, he gives us three. Here we go again. Jude gives us three things that are things that we are to continually be doing to keep ourselves loving God the way we ought. The first one is the very first part of verse 20. You yourselves, beloved, keep on growing in your faith. By growing in our faith, if we love God, we want to be more like God. So we need to grow, we need to develop continually. Nobody has yet arrived where we got to the point where we are not going to need to grow anymore because we are perfect. Thank God I'm perfect. You can laugh. My wife knows I'm not perfect. I know I'm not perfect, and God knows. But you know what? That should be something we're striving for. We may never get it in this life, but it's something we should be working on and striving for, continually growing. Once we accept Christ as our Savior, growth doesn't come automatically. It requires effort on our part. So what do we need to do? Well, reading the Bible is one thing. Do you read it every day, at least every other day? Attending church. I'm speaking, of course, to those who are in church. That's a good thing. And those of you who are listening at home, watching the television, you need to come to church sometime. If you can. If you can't, thank God we can have option for you. That's another way. Respond to the biblical sermons. You've been there. I don't know how long I'm going here. You've been there. I've been there. I hear a sermon. I go home. We're at lunch. My wife says, what did you think of the pastor's sermon? I'm saying, let's see, the pastor's sermon. What in the world was he talking about today? You've never been there, right? We've all been there. Well, we need to figure out somehow how to respond to it. And then connecting and fellowshipping with like-minded believers. You know what? You cannot grow all the way God wants you to grow all by yourself. You need the persons that are in this room. You need people sitting next to you. You need somebody to be able to look at life, Christian life, in a way different than you see it and point out to you some things that maybe needs adjustment or how to do something a little better. You need somebody to rub shoulders with. You do. If you're going to grow. Well, those are just some ways. The second thing is by praying in the Spirit. If we love God, we want to talk to God, right? If you love your wife, you want to talk to your wife, right? I know when I was in Korea, my wife was in I don't know where she was at that time, Alabama, I guess it was. I wanted to talk to her. Couldn't do it very often, but once a month we had an option through Mars Radio to be able to talk to our wife. It was kind of an awkward thing to do that way, but that's what it was important to do. But if you love somebody, you want to connect with them and talk with them, don't you? If you love God, you want to talk to him. And guess what? God wants us to talk to him. He talks to us. He wants us to talk to him. So keep yourself in the love of God. Talk to God. That's one way to do it, praying in the Holy Spirit. It's an individual matter. We do it corporately, but really we're doing it individually, together. But also when we're alone, we do it. And then he has this third thing. You may think, oh, this is kind of strange to put this in here as a matter of how to keep ourselves in love for God. I have it here as anticipating heaven or expecting the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ and the eternal life. What does that mean? How does that relate to anything? Well, God promised us mercy and an eternity with him. If we have a take it or leave it attitude, yeah, I'm going to heaven, so what, big deal, when I die, that's why I'll wake up, and I'm happy with that, but that's the end of it for me. No, that something's wrong if that's where we're at. You know what, when I was in Korea, it wasn't good enough just to talk on the phone once a month to my wife and maybe say hi to the kids. I really wanted to be with her. You know that? If God says, I got a place in heaven for you, even a place for you to live, and guess what? We're going to be there together. If we're not really excited about that truth, that we're going to be with God forever, well, then there's something wrong with our love for God if we don't want to be with him. Now, we're not going to accelerate the process, of course, and say, go there. But the bottom line is we want to be with him and anticipate it, right? Remember Apostle Paul in the book of Philippians. What did he say? I've got a real problem, folks. He's writing to the Philippian people. I would rather be with Christ than be here with you. No, he was writing in a letter, so he wasn't really with him in that sense. But my problem is God says, no, you have to stay here. And I said, oh, do I have to put up with this again? I want to go. He says, no. Okay, so that was his big problem. How often has that been our big problem? Now, don't get me wrong on this. We get sick, real sick, let's say. And the worst part of that, we think, is, well, we die and we go to heaven. The best thing that could happen to us is to go to heaven. But that's not how we think about it, is it? Huh? No way. We want to stay here, right? We should be excited. If we really love God, we should show that by really looking forward to that time when we're going to be with him forever. Apostle John did. The very end of the book of Revelation, the last prayer of the Bible, should be ours every morning probably. Even so, come, Lord Jesus, bring us home. Let's get it going. Well, at any rate, we need, if we're going to be obedient disciples, we need to not only retain our love for God, but we also need to retain our love for people. A love for people. Now we're getting to the missionary point. Okay? If we're growing disciples, we'll be like Jesus. He says, come after me and I'll make you fishers of men. That's what he said. Okay? If we're growing disciples, then we're going to be exercising our missionary activity. But just exactly in what way do we do that? Well, Jude lists three kinds of people that we can touch. Locally. Don't have to go to Korea to do it. Though they got them over there too. But yes, locally we can touch these people. One, probably better move quickly, right? He says quickly, okay. He gave me 20 minutes, but my watch don't work right. I don't understand. Some people are unsure. Those who are questioning have doubts. They're really not sure of what's going on. Maybe they're believers, maybe they're not. Maybe they're just in the process. they haven't really arrived yet in their mind, maybe in their heart fully. Well, we can connect with those kind of people. There are people out there who are not sure about why we believe what we believe, or does the Bible really mean what it says here? We can help those people. That's a missionary activity. There's another group of people. Those are people who are unsaved people. They don't like us. They don't like our teaching. They might hit us in the nose. They're bound for hell. He says, look, have mercy on those people. You receive mercy from God, have mercy on those people. Have mercy on the doubters, and certainly have mercy on those who are bound for hell, snatching them out of the fire, he says. Doing the best we can to point them in a different direction. Those are the unsaved people. They're hell bound. And then there's some unspiritual people. They're believers, but they somehow got off track. We don't know any of those because we've never been there ourselves, right? We've all been there. And we need somebody to help us to get back on track. And he says here now, those people, you need the help. Those that are fallen into sin somehow. Show mercy, hate in fear, hating even the garment spotted by the flesh. Don't fall in line with their activities. Try to get them to change their viewpoint on certain things. Turn around. Become more like Christ. Well, real quickly here, I got to be finishing up here. He says he's going to, it's that big hook that's going to come out somewhere along the line and drag me off of here. So I'm going to finish. So, reviewing, just review, real quickly review. We need to consider our spiritual environment as missionaries and recognize that we're in a conflict and we want to not avoid that by hiding our truth. Secondly, we need to concentrate on our own spiritual development, and that really comes first before, in fact, we can get out there and win people to Christ. We got to be disciples, growing people who are growing in holiness to move people in that direction. And then we need to connect. This is our option here. Connect with spiritually needy people all about us. Maybe unsure, unsaved, unspiritual. There's people all around us. You know them, I know them. And fall into one of these categories. Connect. We need to connect. To be a missionary does not mean that we have to cross the seas. Sometimes all we have to do is to see somebody in the laundromat or across the fence. Maybe somebody is sitting next to you to touch them. We don't have to cross the seas, but wherever we are, and right now we're local, wherever we are, we need, in fact, to recognize that we, in fact, are mandated, commanded to touch people for Jesus. It's our job. Now, here's my application thing here, okay? I had a real struggle with this. If you don't like it, it's his fault. If you do like it, okay, we'll go with that. Here's what I want. Everybody, right now, who is a missionary on the local scene, I want you to stand up. Everybody who's working on the local scene is a missionary, I want you to stand up. Right? But now this is the quiz part. Okay? Everybody should be standing. Right? Everybody is a missionary on the local scene. If you can stand up, stand up. You're a missionary. Okay? We need to figure out exactly how God wants us, how God wants me to exercise that responsibility in my local area. Let's pray.